son of a bitch. I'm a baseball coach. Everybody curses in baseball. It's a man's profession, so we curse. Not that that's good.
Side, an artistic side, even though it wasn't expressed in actually making things, because it expressed itself more in his work, in his play, in the way he interacted with people, and especially the way he interacted with kids. Yeah. We would have fun with seeing things that weren't officially art, but that were very beautiful.
Mm.
So I don't remember exactly when he started making things, but I know he started to collect things. He was always like a kid bringing home a special treat.
Yeah.
I'm like, look what I got, because it was inevitably, it was either at a garage sale, so it was some great buy, as well as something beautiful in his eyes, and nobody else thought it was.
Yeah.
And then as he started to make things, it was just sort of really amazing to witness it, as it's unfolded, and the breadth of the things that he finds interesting, from taking walks with you guys in Keyport and bringing back natural junk.
Oh, and forgive my hose, I'm about to have a heart attack. So I have to wear oxygen so I don't. Sorry. Jeez, what a pain in the ass. Anyway, this red lens, $3 at a garage sale attached to a lamp, which I only want paid for the lens, but I liked it enough, so I paid $3. What the hell? You can buy a hacksaw for $1 and get 10 blades for another $1, and the hardware store, of course. Pop, pop.
Hitting on one, pop it, pop it, pop it, pop it, go to motorcycle, hitting on two.
I don't go there. That's his sanctum, I just, the house is big enough that I can stay away from his places, because he's interesting in that way, in that he really likes order. Mm-hmm. He likes our living, both of us like our living space to be sort of calm and not chaotic. But his workspace sometimes gets pretty chaotic, that back storeroom, even his office. But I just sort of know that that's his. And
that's a cool look, but I don't even take a picture of it. The beauty of this piece, This is separate from this. This comes from the meat grinder. As I said, this screwed perfectly into this with the same size, same gauge screw, and it fit perfectly into the existing hole in the chopped liver maker. This is one of those bowls that your grandmother made chopped liver in. And it was a great base for another sculpture until that sculpture dissipated. All right, let's go see what we got down there. A guy like me, every 3 days or so, I got to come down here and straighten out the mess and make it less of a mess. And that's what I'm doing. I also have to do my laundry. Picasso did not share a studio with a laundromat. Then again, in the immortal words of that presidential candidate, I knew Picasso and you're no Picasso. I knew Kennedy, and believe me, you're no John Kennedy. Well, see this thing? It's some kind of filter. It's oily. And I'm thinking, I know I can drill a hole in there perfectly, and it's already got a mesh. And I'm thinking that if I can clean it well, I got myself a beautiful lamp. Just perfect. Nice mesh, yellow, red on top, red glow look. So it would look like that. Red on the bottom. Grab a piece of steel wool and start praying first, of course, that it works. Aha! Success of sorts. Yeah, it's going to work. Just takes elbow grease. This is one of those, there's no short fix. Got to get in there and spray away. And one benefit of this whole process is that the ZEP ZEP degreaser smells good. It's like orange smell. It reminds me of St. Joseph's aspirin for children. Yeah, it looks like I'm going to have a real nice piece there if I stick to it. And when I get the feeling, one thing I'll say about me is when I get the feeling that something's going to work, I stick to it. I work my butt off on it because I so love to turn out something new. It's so much fun to bring it upstairs and look at it and put it in a place in a house where it might sit for somebody or me or Ellen. Now, if I was very rich or had big backing, I could make this 40 feet tall and I'd have a famous sculpture. But I'm not very rich and don't have big backing, so I work in miniature. I think this would be an amazing sculpture in a park. Everybody would come to look at it. But it's the only way I can create it. So we all have limitations. Here's the edge piece that I found at some garage sale, some garbage, who knows where. And I spray painted the back, realizing that the light would come through, but not realizing how to do it very well. And I'm not sure whether it works or not, but I'm going to check around further and try to use this piece, because I kind of like the abstract. I certainly like the light. I like the word edge in it. Somehow I'll keep, this is what my modus operandi perfectly. I let it sit here, I keep looking, keep playing, keep looking to utilize it in different places. Like, man, that would be a nice little table. I mean, we're talking where you put your drinks on plexiglass. And if I could put a little light inside there, I'm even better. Just take out the innards. And in fact, this very piece of equipment is in the Modern Museum in their design section, believe it or not, as an example of one of the great designs, industrial designs of the 50s or whenever. show. The best piece of art in the house, Shauna Cole, age 10, fifth grade, the cow jumped over the moon ceramics. I don't have to say another word. It's amazing how kids, of course my own daughter, but kids turn out. Look at the squiggles on the side. Look at the pock marks. Look at the stars. Look at the moon and the cow. Looking like a wooden bucket, this hammer and nail, and you try that with an aluminum pen. All right, don't tell Ellen I didn't take it off the wall to hammer it. So the bucket piece is a classic of mine. When we were at Cape Med Point for a week, most summers, this African-American family led by the matriarchs, probably in her late 70s, her sister and sons and the daughters, they run this cool old antique shop that's slash antique and junk. The prices are reasonable. They like when I come in because I always show up. And they know I'm an artist, and they like to get the stuff to use. And I bought this old bucket there. But the piece has a quandary for me, because I like the way it looks, but I don't know what it means. It's nothing but a visual. I could call it a broken bucket list, but it doesn't feel right to me. I'm trying to figure something out to say about people who worked with their hands and washed floors with this bucket, which must have been hands and knees kind of thing. So this is called 18 East. It's an autobiographical piece about my childhood in my apartment building on Price Street in Linden. We lived at 18 East Price Street. And I found these various pieces of metal, God knows where, on the street or construction site. And I added the components of our lock from our door when we changed it. It was a 75-year-old lock, which works a whole lot better than the modern one. And slowly but surely built this piece to remind me of our old apartment building. I love the windows, and this piece, there's a window over here, but it's just like this one. These were always here. They represent the electrical boxes on the telephone pole in front of my house, right to this side. And I always was fascinated by them because they crackled and they made noise, and sometimes they, a little ozone would come off there. It was pretty cool. These are the trees or the kids playing in the yard, however you want to interpret sort of boundary line of our backyard and the next house. And I really like these colors, and they're bright to me. The locks and the doorknob, of course, we could never get into our apartment when we were kids. If you got locked out, you got locked in, and if you had to take a pee, you had to go down the cellar and beg the landlady to let you in your apartment, and she would mock you for shaking. She said, oh, you're standing there going like this, aren't you? You must really have to go. She was a real bastard. Your husband wasn't much better, but better. They remind me of sort of the Parisian, the metro in Paris, the lights and the beautiful wrought iron work that when you come into the metro stops, there's this sort of always bent kind of arrhythmic rhythmicality, if you will, and different beautiful subtle colors. I just put these on this week, these springs. You know, I'm in love with springs, and these are particularly good springs because they're long, they have stems, different colors, different angles, orange, white, a brown one. And I matched up these glass pieces that I have. Bill Jackalone, Blown Art, by the way, by him. He did this, he made it. An old flash bulb and a glass tear or bead that I found a bunch of once in. Now I'm toying with the idea of adding this wonderful Pez piece, the candy piece, because it's obvious, beautiful attraction. And it's sort of a play on Gaudí and La Pedrera, his amazing apartment building in Barcelona that has those incredible chimneys that are sculptures of people. They're huge, they're monumental, and they're about on that size and proportionately to the building. Of course, this building is one of the most famous buildings in the world. Circular apartments go like this. They're out of this world place. The most incredible features that you imagine of crazy Gaudi stuff. Anyway, I'm toying with the idea, get it? Toying with the idea of leaving that there as an ode to Gaudí of sorts, and just because it represents childhood fun. So this is a classic piece for me, because there's so many entities that came together, so many components that came together on it. The first thing I found was this piece at my junkyard over the Motors joint over on Route 18, where they let me peruse the back and find whatever I want. I found this piece because it had such a lifelike figure to it. It's some kind of pump part outside of a pump, and it had this lifelike kind of belly or whatever. It just looks very lifelike to me and bird-like. And then came this from the same place. This is another cover to a machine, some kind of pump, electric pump, which is what they do. And I love the shape, and it had holes, it's kind of sockets for these eyes. And then came this spring, which I'm always collecting spring-like things, and it became the hair. And slowly but surely, I attached the whole thing. And this I found was an old can in the street. It was crushed together. I just opened it, and I felt it was beaked nose-like. And this is the bottom of an old trophy, an old plaque from trophies, which the underside of plaque, old darkened plaques, which I always find, has beautiful wood in of its own, always. Nice two colors. I've used it many, many times. It has these nice holes in it. These things screwed on easily, glued on easily. These are screwed and glued. And it just looks like a primitive piece to me. It's a sort of an aboriginal life piece that depicts the way the ancients looked at the world and the figures and animals and birds, whatever, that they revered as life, as life-sustaining, because they did sustain their lives, and they worshipped and needed nature in a way that we seem to be forgetting. So this is a piece by my friend Giovanna Lupi. She was an old girlfriend of mine back in the early 80s, and we never talked much about art. She said she was interested in art, but I didn't know the depth of what her interest. She was a pharmacist, and after years of communicating sporadically, after 9/11, she wrote me a long email about how terrible it was that 9/11 had taken place. And we started up our correspondence strongly after that, and we've seen each other, the families have met, we really have a nice friendship. And it turned out that she does exactly the same art that I do, precisely. She's a found objects artist, and she's a very feminine artist. Who works very delicately and very beautifully, and mostly does what she calls sculpture luminose, which means, without my bad Italian accent, which means light sculptures. That's it. That's Giovanna Lupi's piece, and it's called, I dubbed it Homesick Horse, because of course it's all the way from Vicenza. Well, Buckart, I went over to Buckart, to the bookstore, and I looked and saw what was there, and without quite knowing, I was going to make two pieces, one floating apparitions or mushrooms or stars or clusters, whatever, just floating from dangling string, and I was going to make another piece out of these, just sticking straight up. And then when I got these straight up in this disc that I bought for a base for something, anything, which it turned out right, I took one look at it and realized that it needed something on top. I had to bend these a lot, and I wet them a little bit and bent them and kept shaping them like this. You know, I just kept doing it. They're very resilient. They come from an Easter basket. They're the top of the Easter basket. They were a buck a piece. So these were, how many are there? There's eight. That was $8. And four of these are exactly $2, $10.
So you had a limit on what you had to spend.
There's a limit on Buck Art, $10. So this is exactly $10 worth. So,
did you have a name for it?
Yeah, Glitterati. It's called Glitterati after the famous combination of glitter people and literature people. Literati, Glitterati.
Via, via. Vieni via di qui. Niente più ti lega questi luoghi, neanche questi fiori azzurri. Via via, neanche questo tempo grigio, pieno di musiche, e gli uomini che ti sono piaciuti. It's wonderful, it's wonderful, it's wonderful, good luck my baby. It's wonderful, it's wonderful that we're with you. Chips, chips, da-di-doo-di-doo, chibum, chibum, boom.
This piece is called Floods, Roselle, New Jersey. It's a total joke in the title on Twins, Roselle, New Jersey, Diane Arbus, a famous photograph that she took, Roselle being my hometown. And she took this picture, maybe 53 or 57 or something, I don't know when, of these two twins dressed the same. And it's, the name of the piece is Twins, Roselle, New Jersey. So these are Floods, Roselle, New Jersey, because when I was a kid, the black guys, if your pants were too short, would say, yo, Cole, what's with those floods, man? You got some high waters on, Cole. What's wrong with you, man? Floods. What you doing with them floods, Cole? So you can see that the pants are high on the shoes. And Floods, Roselle, New
Jersey. Via, via. Vieni via con me. Entra in questo amore buio, non perditi per niente al mondo. Via, via, non perditi per niente al mondo. Lo spettacolo d'arte varia di un innamorato di te. It's wonderful, it's wonderful, it's wonderful, good luck my baby. It's wonderful, it's wonderful that we're with you. Chips, 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 dati do di do, chi boom, chi boom, boom. Dati do di do, chi boom, chi boom, boom. Dati do di do.
Talk about art. You have all these choices and all these options to follow, to find rather. And in the case, everybody who works with found objects like I do always says the material shapes your piece, and that's true in the baseline, but then you get to shape around and sculpt around the material by adding and detracting and reshaping and cutting off or painting, you know, and giving it features, giving it ideas that make it more what you're thinking about wanting to represent. Well, serendipity happens to me a lot. Not that it's good or bad, but if you come down to the storeroom, which Bill has already photographed and filmed, there's so much in there that often I'm working on a piece and I go in to look for one thing to add to it, and I see another and I go, holy smokes, there's my answer sitting right in front of me for 2 years. I remember when I started to do art seriously, and they did a newspaper article on me in a sports page for the home news, because I'm a baseball coach around here, and it talked about found art and going looking in garbage and this and that. One of the coaches, who's a funny young guy, and he was standing at a game and he had finished drinking a can of Coca-Cola, and he crumpled up the can and he handed it to me. He said, here, coach, here's some garbage for your art.
Or stuff, you know, inevitably, you know, not just garage sales, but garbage. So, and that was, if you were to interview Shauna, she would talk about how embarrassed she would be, because he would pull over sometimes next to somebody's garbage heap and say, oh, wait, just a second, I gotta get that.
I don't mix baseball and art very much, because they're both, they're far apart in the real thing that goes on, but the intensity is exactly the same.
Do you remember the first piece that you did that made you think that maybe I'm an artist, or?
I guess the first piece I made, I really liked, that the Aboriginal piece by the doorway that you shot before, Bill. But it didn't make me feel like I was an artist. I felt like I just created something. I'm trying to think of one where I really felt like, wow. Maybe the yellow piece behind you when it was a standing piece, and the way it was shown at this Gallery 14 in Morristown. It was a very, it's the Geraldine R. Dodge Foundation headquarters, and not the first time, but they put me in a place that was an all-natural setting within the building. It's a totally green building. I had a whole place to myself, and this was the centerpiece of a large gravel area under a stairway with a green wall, growing plants, up a wall with a kind of a fountain effect. And a guy did a story about me and the piece and being a baseball coach, and that felt pretty good. And selling something at the Nexus show at the New Jersey Arts Guild was, that was fun. A piece I made that Jeff and Maria have, people I mentioned before, is an especially nice piece to me. It was very simple. It was totally serendipitous. I just kind of hung it together to look at it, and it was there in a split second. I felt like an artist for a long time.
Well, I think he does now. I think for a long time he didn't. I can remember him talking about that, that it was, he just thought it was a hobby.
Yeah.
But then I think being in some of the shows, I think he started to realize, I guess, because when we meet people, he'll say, well, I'm a sculptor.
Yeah.
He'll say that now.
Yeah, right.
Whereas for a long time he didn't. He just thought of it as something he did, you know.
Yeah.
This piece was, I bought a skateboard, and this was the seven wheels on each end of the skateboard, and I never saw anything quite like this, but I knew right away it had the potential to be a bug. It's had a few lives, if you will, incarnations, I guess you could say, and finally I connected it with something or other, a big screw or something. Flexible screw you can buy at the hardware store, and added the tail, which I really love. And just yesterday I finished off the antennae with the beads and these pink doohickeys from Carpenter Elementary School that I used to buy on the 25-cent day when their kids would sell them at lunch. And it just, it's what you see is what it is. I'm toying with putting some eyes in here, but that'd be a lot of work, and I don't know if it would really, probably it would work well. I'll think about it. Anyway, this piece, insulators from the railroad, ceramic insulators connected by heavy metal. That metal you see on top, it's all through there in three connectors. And I bought it at a garage sale on Barim Avenue in Milltown for $2. The hardest part of this piece was to get it to stand up straight. It's a combination. I put a lot of nails in between the hinges and a lot of glue. And I kept scraping the glue out and putting more nails until it's stuck. It's completely stuck on my own crazy system. And I'm giving it to my friends Jeff Zajac and Maria Mataliano as a present for their backyard, because they have such a great backyard, and it sort of, to me, would be a very proud thing to have my piece in their yard. Their yard is of another country, place, planet, I don't know. It's really wonderful. So here's Maria Mataliano and Jeff Zajac's backyard, and to me, it's beyond innovative. It's unique for sure, but I think it really reflects the interest that Maria and Jeff have in so many things, in being thoroughly efficient, and being in researching things, in doing things the right way, and bringing their environment to themselves so that they're comfortable and happy. And with that, of course, goes tremendous work that they put in back here. I mean, I love being in exotic places and places that are different than America, and to me this particular property and the home are, I don't want to say European, that's too cliched, but they're so different than most places that you'd see, and they evoke to me the countryside
in New Jersey, where we stayed in Huntington County when I was a little kid, and where the people had wonderful gardens and it was beautiful nature and a pond to swim in, and it always evokes that feeling to me. And then there's just a sparse amount of sculpture and artwork throughout the property that surprises you when you come to it. And there are these paths to follow and little nooks. What did you call that place, Bill?
The Copse.
The Copse, off to the side of the house, a shady little nook. It says something. Art is supposed to say something. You write a song, or you sing a song, or you draw a painting, or you do some comedy, you do some stand-up. You're supposed to be able to connect with people on their level, so that on a lot of people's levels, so it's something, I don't want to say universal, it's too scary, but you know, you want to connect. Spring from an old chaise lounge and kind of painted it however, and made that hanging piece from it. And I just like the way it looks. It can be shaped and reshaped any way you want. It's been a standing piece. And this piece came from the edger that you push along a big pole, and the three of them were on like a little rake type apparatus. And I just loved the shape so much I figured out how to get them apart really easily. I knew they had great ability as stars, or just creatures, or, you know, the stars, really. I mean, it's sort of like Jean Cocteau's stars. He's always using stars, that guy, from what I saw of his work. And it reminds me of something of his, so it has a little historical perspective to me. So these two pieces, I really like them. That's why
the fish, that big spring, was sticking out of a dumpster in New York City, and I was too short, too old, too stiff, and too everything to get it. So coming along the street is this big, tall guy in a pair of beautiful, brand new work boots. And I said to him, can you grab that from me? And without a word, he put his one foot like real high up on this little ledge, jumped up, grabbed the side of the dumpster, grabbed the spring, and gave it to me. I said, thanks. He said, you're welcome. End of story. So this is a wood shredder that I saw in Edison on Central Avenue on the way to the train station. And it was out on the lawn in the place where people throw things out. And I love the shape, and I just love the colors and the wheels and everything. But I wouldn't take it before I went to the people and knocked on their door and asked them if it was garbage. I said to them I didn't want to steal anything for art. I try really hard not to do that. In fact, I've succeeded. Don't know what I'm going to do with it. I have no clue yet, but I'm leaving it here for observation purposes. And kids, our roller coaster were these things in the back of the King supermarket that went down and around, and we used to run on a flat board and jump on a flat piece of plywood and take our life in our hands rolling down these rollers. So I saw one of these at a garage sale. I bought it immediately because of the reminiscent value. It was better before they tore down our tree, the bastards, because they had moved it, but it's okay. And I really like it. It's a nice
people seem to like it. I like it. I don't know. It doesn't say much, but we can make up some bullshit about it. Half Moon on the Lawn. The Owl was part of our Owl project, led by Ellen Rebarber, and Lucky Joe was involved as well, Joe Boscarino. And it was just my reaction to how to do it. And I have a lot of these metal colored pieces that are very flexible. They come from those machine, those toys in the doctor's office where the kids play with the beads and they go all over like the roller coaster. And I love those things. And I had these spinners, and when the wind blows, they do blow. I've learned a lot about that. I've got to turn them actually so that they all blow together. If you turn them in the exact same angle, they'll all blow together. They work. And then the glasses, the piece is called All the Better to See You With, because the glasses magnify the owl's already big eyes. And the birds I found, you know, around different things. And there's a nice frog down there. There's an insect right here, a little hard to see. But there's an insect on that stripe, branch, which I put on the base. You know, just play with it. And I really like it. It was in the senior citizen center. And much to my chagrin, they shoved it in the corner behind the refrigerator truck or something. And so I took it out of there because they didn't care about it. And they're too busy, whatever, no complaint. But they didn't care about where it was placed, and I felt better here. When it snows, the snow fills up the top like a hat and in the glasses. And we can always tell how much snow there is by that from the kitchen. And my wife, Ellen Levine, loves it. And somebody wanted to buy it, but she nixed the deal.
So no, it's great. And he's also, I wouldn't even say I'm tolerant. I like what he does. But what I appreciate is that he always, you know, he often doesn't agree with my opinion. I'll sometimes say, oh, that's okay. And he'll go, well, Bill thinks it's great.
Yeah.
Like, okay, well, it's okay, you know, but I'm very honest with him. And then I also really love that over the years, because he's sold or given his things to so many of our friends and family, that I keep seeing his stuff, you know, in other parts of our lives. You know, we visit people and there's one of his old pieces that I've completely forgotten about.
Vieni via di qui, niente più ti lega questi luoghi, neanche questi fiori azzurri. Via via, neanche questo tempo grigio, pieno di musiche e di uomini che ti sono piaciuti. It's wonderful, it's wonderful, it's wonderful, good luck my baby. It's wonderful, it's wonderful that we're a few. Chips, chips. Da-di-do-di-do, chi-boom, chi-boom-boom. Da-di-do-di-do, chi-boom, chi-boom-boom. Da-di-do-di-do.